Disconnect. The truth about cell phone radiation, what industry has done to hide it, and how to protect your family. By Devra Davis, Ph.D., M.P.H. Narrated by Emily Durante. Copyright 2010 by Devra Davis. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Dutton, a member of Penguin Group USA Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2010 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Foreword. If that were true, we'd know about it. I once had a short conversation about health effects of cell phone radiation with the current and a past director of the National Cancer Institute at a cocktail party following a public talk. They both dismissed the topic offhand. First, there's never been any evidence that electromagnetic fields can affect DNA. Thus, they simply cannot contribute to cancer risk. Second, epidemiological studies have never documented an increased risk of brain tumors from cell phone use. And third, there has been no increase in the global number of brain tumors, which, surely, we'd have seen given the large number of people using cell phones today. Case closed. As this book will show you, just scratching the surface of what is known about health risks of cell phone electromagnetic radiation is enough to easily dismiss all three of these arguments. I knew that at the time. So what struck me was the degree to which these two brilliant men, outstanding doctors and world-class scientists, were utterly convinced that this was not a worthwhile area of scientific inquiry. The question in my mind continues to resonate to this day. How can this be? The best answer I've been able to come up with since then is that for most reasonable people, including the scientific leaders of our prestigious medical institutions, it is inconceivable that if cell phones caused health problems, we wouldn't already know about it. If it were true that these devices cause harm, we would know. I myself, a physician, a scientist, a patient being followed for a malignant brain tumor for the past 18 years, lived with exactly the same assumption. I used a cell phone just like everybody else. I had heard, like my NCI colleagues, of all the studies that had never found a convincing link between cell phone use and cancer risk. That seemed reassuring enough. I was convinced, as well, that such technology could not possibly be released on the enormous scale that it has reached today without governments having demanded proof that there could be no health hazards from the widespread use of a new type of microwave radiation that practically everyone would be intensely exposed to for decades. In fact, I had been using my cell phone for many years, in spite of being a brain tumor patient in remission, without any self-consciousness, until an impromptu dinner with the author of this book one summer evening in Pittsburgh. Dr. Davis had recently accepted to head a Center for Environmental Oncology at the university's Hillman Cancer Center, and somebody had suggested we should meet. I was intrigued by the intelligence and the charm of this veteran of many courageous scientific explorations into the link between industrial practices and disastrous public health consequences. Then, my cell phone, which at that time I was carrying in my pocket, rang loudly, and I noticed the horrified expression of my dinner mate when I answered the call by putting the phone directly to my ear. She practically stood up from her seat and shouted, "What? You, of all people, are not using an earpiece?" After I finished my call and gave her a quizzical look about her behavior, she asked me two plain questions that have remained engraved in my memory as the perfect conversation starter with anyone who thinks, like I did, that they know there cannot be a health problem with cell phone radiation. 1. Did you know that most cell phones come with a notice that says, "Do not hold closer than 1 inch from your body?" 2. Did you know that insurance companies refuse to provide coverage to cell phone companies and operators in case of claims of health damage from long-term operation of their devices? This is when I realized how little I really knew about the studies so often referred to in order to dismiss any type of health concern about cell phones, and how much I was going to have to learn. I didn't stop at what Dr. Davis told me that evening. I've learned that in science, the opinion of a single person, however smart and diligent, does not truth make. I did look up the studies. I read the thoroughly documented report of the Bioinitiative Working Group that was published in August 2007 by many of the leading scientists in this field after reviewing practically all the literature available at the time. What I found is precisely what this book describes, an immense disconnect between the common public and medical opinion about cell phone safety and what the data actually said. A year later, Dr. Davis and I helped organize a consensus statement of 20 international scientists and oncologists to emphasize the importance of protecting children from cell phone exposure and the urgent need for more research on how electromagnetic fields from cell phones affect biological mechanisms sustaining health or causing disease. I am proud today that she asked me to write the foreword for her book summarizing all she has found over the years. The politics of science and the pressures of business have not been kind to scientists, such as Dr. Davis, who have been among the first to call attention to a possible public health effect of new technology. We don't want to believe that our new toys to which we are so attached, and which bring in enormous profits, could also cause our demise or that of our children. But science is not about belief. Governments' responsibility to their citizens should not be either. This debate brought forth with talent, clarity, and power of argument in this book by Dr. Davis should be about facts and about our choices in view of those facts. Let us hope that this is just the kind of conversation that we'll be starting. David Servan Schreiber, MD, PhD, Clinical Professor of Psychiatry, University of Pittsburgh. Adjunct Professor of General Oncology, MD Anderson Cancer Center, University of Texas, Lecturer, School of Medicine of Lyon, France, and author of Anti-Cancer, A New Way of Life. 1. Kids, we'll get back to you. Who can protest and does not is an accomplice in the act. Talmud. Could cell phones be unsafe? When I first heard this idea about 6 years ago, I did not believe it, and I did not want to believe it. I had been an early and enthusiastic adopter of this revolutionary technology, which I put to good use managing a staff of several dozen scientists in two different buildings at the National Academy of Sciences. I used it to stay in touch with my children and husband at odd times and places. I prided myself on being able to keep up with my grad students on the latest geeky applications. I knew that most scientists were convinced it was simply impossible for radio frequency radiation from phones to have any impact on human biology. But, as someone who has spent my entire professional career examining the links between the environment and health, I realized that, like the rest of us, science and scientists follow fads and fashions. Sometimes what everyone wants to believe turns out to be inconveniently wrong. Authorities in technologically sophisticated nations like Israel and Finland, where phones had been used longer and more heavily, began to issue warnings about safer use of phones. I began to look beyond our assumptions about cell phones. In this book, I present what I found. It astonished me, and it still does. I hope by the time you finish listening to this book, you will share my view, and those of growing numbers of experts in this country and abroad, that we would be foolish not to take simple precautions. Cell phone designs can and probably will be improved to lower direct exposures to the brain and body, but in the meantime, we can reduce radio frequency radiation from cell phones while science pursues the matter fully, something it has not yet done. Contrary to the firmly held beliefs of many respected authorities, invisible radio frequency radiation can alter living cells and create the same types of damage that we know increase the risk of cancer and neurological disease. Neither the danger nor the safety of cell phones is yet certain. How we manage that uncertainty could avert a global public health catastrophe. Each one of our world's 6+ billion people starts life with a brain that is not fully formed. With luck and decent nutrition, by the time we hit our early 20s, our brains have become completely wired. By the time you are reading this book, there will be about 5 billion cell phones on this planet. You may even own 2 of them. And you almost certainly know many people with growing brains, anyone under 25, who regularly use cell phones. Children are growing up in a sea of radio frequency radiation that did not exist even 5 years ago. Cell phones have revolutionized our ability to respond to emergencies, real and imagined. They provide social status. They help you find a job. They neatly store all the music you want to listen to and summon up loved ones anytime, anywhere. They seem essential to connecting you with whatever you want to do, track stocks, share favorite photos, download sports results, and send text, images, videos, and voice notes throughout the global village. To succeed, you need to be reachable 24/7. And who can argue that these wonderful gadgets do make you feel more in touch, more effective, more, well, fun? The newest generation of phones brings us closer, faster, and nearer to each other than ever before. Cell phones today are like electricity and water, things we can't live without. They seem so benign and so invaluable. Cell phones are used to call ambulances, but are never the reason for the call in the first place. Yet we have overlooked something more insidious than the dangers of texting while driving. There is a disconnect between the way that cell phones tie us all together and what these revolutionary tools can do to our bodies as they press up against our ears every day. I'm probably a 10th generation bubby, the Yiddish word for grandmother. Actually, my own mother liked to be called by the American moniker, Grandma Jean. But, in fact, she came, like me, from a long line of bubbies. Bubby Fanny, Bubby Pearl, Bubby Leah. Just like all grandmothers in the world, I want to keep my grandchildren safe. My grandkids come equipped with an array of modern protective armor. They have their own car seats and bike helmets and know all about the need to buckle up. My eldest grandchild, Davis, nearly 5, wears a white plastic helmet sitting tightly over his dark brown curly hair and black Velcro pads for wrists, knees, and elbows whenever he rides his skateboard. He is a grandmother's delight in blue jeans and a red checkered shirt swooshing down the sidewalk by Capitol Hill, excellent skateboarding terrain close to our home. Davis is all concentration as he waits until the walk is clear. He heads pell-mell straight down the middle of the pavement, stops the board abruptly by stepping down hard on the back edge, makes it pop right up in the air, then proudly hops off, usually without falling. I actually have a hard time walking as fast as he can ride. Just over 3 feet tall, Davis rules the sidewalk, just as long as his sister Josephine, a mere 18 months younger and 6 inches shorter, lets him. Curly brown-haired Josephine proudly pedals her tricycle as fast as she can, tongue sticking out. Her helmet is shimmery pink as she pedals right at her older brother Davis, but she stops short. Jojo has already perfected that second child victim pout. She's about to whine. Watching my 2 toddler grandchildren at play as they jockey for position on the sidewalk, I can almost hear the neurons firing. The difference between being alive and being dead is just one thing, the presence of electrical activity in the brain. Josephine and Davis know they are being watched. They glance plaintively to me, hoping I will intervene. We decide to go inside and see a new family toy. Their dad has brought home a small plastic box that is a bit big for their little hands, with a screen that rotates images. Josephine and Davis are enchanted. They each want that droid. The spanking new phone, the one that plays music, shows cartoons and videos, talks, and tells Dad where to drive and find an open store for soft-serve ice cream. They've grown up with tranquilizing DVDs beamed into the family van. Now, here is a little screen that does all that and a whole lot more. Our brain controls what we see, think, feel, hear, how we sense the world around us. By the 2nd month of prenatal life, a simple cylinder of nerve cells forms in the center of the growing embryo. From this hollow tube, the human brain grows at the incredible speed of 250,000 cells a minute, growing from 0 to 100 billion cells at birth. The brain of an infant triples in weight in the first year of life and doubles to 200 billion cells by the age of 2. There are so many connections among these cells that it would take more than 30 million years merely to count them aloud. With each signal my toddler grandchildren take in, the rods and cones in their eyes dart to whatever most catches their fancy. Their ears tune in to the sound striking their auditory nerves, and their center of wants, the amygdala, presses them onward to demand whatever it is they decide they must have or do. Infants cannot focus their eyes, but they can and do attune to patterns and smells that attract their brains. By the time they are a few months old, babies can see and sense their moms and dads. Their brains settle into regular rhythms to sleep, to eat, to cry, and do it all over again as they grow. Each one of those billions of cells they are born with can be connected to half a dozen others. Infant brains are like small supercomputers, with hard-to-grasp numbers of combinations and permutations inside their soft skulls. What about that phone they are each set to have? What explains its nearly hypnotic power for those tender minds? My grandkids are enthralled by the small, shiny new black droid. But it might be an iPhone or a Palm Pre. The American Academy of Pediatrics advises strongly that parents not rely on television and videos to calm babies. But try telling that to the harried mother of three in diapers. Kids become enthralled, seemingly powerless to resist. Evolution clearly didn't prepare them for this. Nothing so brilliantly colored and musical, so fluctuating and wild, so exquisitely scaled, existed out there on the African savanna 1 million years ago. Davis figured out how to play the common cell phone game, Brick Breaker, before he could read or count. These new toys can be utterly irresistible. Children have always loved to pretend talk on phones. So why shouldn't a kindergartner be able to chatter to his grandparents on the phone, now that he or she can, anywhere, anytime, quite conveniently? The games, internet access, global positioning information. What's the problem with all these interesting treats? Why not give all toddlers a cell phone? The reason is that there is a disconnect between what the scientific world knows about cell phone radiation and the benign reputation these slick gadgets have. If we could take a slow-motion movie of the growth of the brain, we would see that the master computer leading its development spins faster than any mortal can count, and it does not sit in a superhero Iron Man case. Unlike a metal-shelled machine, the skull of a child is very soft. This is a good thing, as it means that when curious, playful infants fall, as they have been doing for millions of years, their heads are less likely to break. A baby's cranium is made of thin bone that continues to grow and ultimately becomes thicker. The faster that any cells are growing, the greater the chance they can make mistakes and endlessly repeat them. The thinner and pliant skulls of children help them survive, as evolution designed. But the lack of 3G cell phones on the African savanna millions of years ago has left children susceptible to the radiation these phones now emit. Try saying a tongue twister slowly. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. How many pecks of pickled peppers did Peter Piper pick? Now, say it again faster. Then, say it as fast as you can. With any increase in speed will come more mistakes. The brain of a 3-year-old weighs 3/4 as much as that of an adult and gobbles up twice as much blood sugar. The young brain continues to grow throughout childhood and adolescence. It's not just the sheer number of brain cells or neurons that increase, it's also the ways that they are connected to one another. Over time, fatty coatings of myelin surround neurons, giving them more strength and resilience. This protective coating is much more than window dressing. Myelin is believed to confer judgment, wisdom, impulse control, and many other properties we associate with maturity and a good life. It will not surprise parents who have survived teenage drivers in the family to learn that the human brain does not fully mature until the 20s, that this maturation happens a bit later for young men than young women, also no surprise to many parents. As with any other developing tissue, the brain is vulnerable to toxic exposures, especially if they occur early on. Infinitesimal amounts of the heavy metal lead encountered in the first 2 years of life can lead to a host of nasty neural consequences. Lead has the same number and kinds of electrons surrounding its atoms as calcium. This means that this toxic metal competes with and can block calcium from being taken into the brain and other vital parts of the body. Calcium is essential for brain and bone health and for our heartbeats and neurons. Lead is not only not needed, it has the ability to throw microscopic monkey wrenches into neurons and synapses if it gets a chance. Children with just a bit too much lead and too little calcium in the first years of life end up with lower intelligence, more problems in school, and ultimately tend to find their ways into jails and mental institutions at much greater rates as young adults. If toddlers exposed to lead develop permanently diminished brains and more criminal and psychiatric problems as adults, how will their minds and bodies be affected by the unprecedented flood of radio frequency signals in which they are growing up today? In the years after World War II, encouraged by the sudden availability and enthusiasm for military surplus technology, doctors thought it made sense to use X-rays to treat ringworm, an infectious disease of the scalp. It worked. The X-rays cleaned up the infection, but they also left a much more toxic legacy. Children whose brains were irradiated for a short period of time to treat scalp infections before age 5 develop almost 4 times more brain tumors by the time they reach middle age than those who didn't go through such treatments. The brain of a child needs all the protection it can get as early and for as long as possible. The helmets my grandson and his sisters wear keep their skulls from getting cracked by sudden falls, but they do nothing to stop the absorption of small microwave signals into their brains that come from phones. Phones today are smaller, smarter, and faster than ever before. Are they as benign as they seem? In 2000, the former Prime Minister of Norway, Gro Harlem Brundtland, a physician, became Director General of the World Health Organization, WHO, the world's premier public health agency. Trained at the Harvard School of Public Health, Brundtland headed the United Nations Commission on Sustainable Development. In 2002, she sat down with a reporter from a leading Norwegian newspaper and revealed that she had banned cell phones from her office at the WHO. During the course of the interview, she began to get a headache. Brundtland asked whether someone in the room might have a cell phone that was on. The newspaper's photographer had turned his ringer off but left his phone on, figuring that Brundtland would never know he had done so. He was wrong. Brundtland was embarrassed by her physical reaction, but it was a problem she could not ignore. "I made several tests. People have been in my office with their mobile hidden in their pocket or bag. Without knowing if it was on or off, I have always reacted when the phone has been on, never when it's off. So..." She did not advise people against using a mobile phone at the time. As a physician, she believed that scientific research had not made the case for offering such advice. Brundtland said that she expected that the world would soon have important information about the long-term impact of cell phones. "At this time, we do not have scientific evidence to go out with a clear warning. It is not established that the radiation, for instance, can result in brain cancer. WHO has a big study going on, and in 2 or 3 years from now, we will have better answers to all these questions. In other words, we'll get back to you." In fact, it took more than 8 years for that study to be released. The official verdict is that biases and errors limit the strength of the conclusions that can be drawn. They advise that further investigation of mobile phone use and brain cancer risk is merited. This scenario begins to reveal why there is such an extraordinary disconnect between what scientists have come to learn in the last few years, building on little-known research that is now decades old, and the miraculous, unquestioned, and benign aura of today's smartphones. This book is about that disconnect. 2. How the fires of technology shock and awe. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away, but he is no longer the only one to do so. Aldo Leopold. The dawn of history is best seen in retrospect. What some people are confident is an historic fundamental breakthrough can turn out to be just another blind alley. Advertising copywriters thrive on their ability to portray products as revolutionary and novel wonders. What's new sells. For close to a decade, some of Silicon Valley's best and brightest invested in a top-secret project they believed would change the world, a mechanized mobile platform sitting half a foot off the ground that could wheel itself downstairs. Called Project IT, the Segway rolled out in December of 2001 as a revolution in interpersonal transport. Sitting atop two large rubber wheels, the gigantic scooter base includes built-in computers and balancing devices that allow the disabled and the out of condition to cover long distances on urban walkways and negotiate curbs and other challenges unimpeded. The hoped-for revolution in personal transport the Segway was meant to usher in did not occur. At one point, a huge factory was ramped up to take thousands of orders and $1 billion in sales that never materialized. As with much cutting-edge technology, and the Segway does have some ingenious engineering at its heart, what works on the planning board or in the lab does not always turn out so well in real life. The Segway came to look like the creation of brilliant engineers who were not alert to how little people dislike walking. It seems they also neglected to consider the peak flow problem, namely, that crowded, bustling city sidewalks could not handle posses of elevated grown-ups on scooters. But, after all, many of us simply aren't excited by the prospect of being propelled distances of up to 11 miles at a pace of 10 miles an hour on a vehicle that costs as much as a used car. Today, Segways are used by Washington, D.C. tourists and security officers whisking around cavernous shopping malls, a market, to be sure, but not the one investors hoped for, given the research and development money they put into the project. Those who ponied up $90 million in the spring of 2000 owned 15% of the company. Even before a single machine was built, Segway's paper value was well over half a billion. Engineers consider them beautiful pieces of engineering, but it is hard not to think of Segways if you watch the animated movie WALL-E, which features obese humans incapacitated by their weight that are smoothly and swiftly transported around their cruise liner's decks as they slurp down junk food, hypnotized by ubiquitous video screens. Motorola, 1972. At the beginning, it was not at all clear that mobile phones would be any different. Their invention came about mostly as a corporate strategy to keep one firm from monopolizing a set of radio channels that looked as if they might one day be valuable. In 1972, Robert Galvin, CEO of Motorola, learned that AT&T intended to create a truly mobile phone, thereby staking a claim for sole corporate control of all future wireless networks. Galvin understood that if AT&T prevailed, this would not only solidify their control over the cumbersome car phones AT&T was already selling to a limited number of businessmen and the extravagantly wealthy, it would box Motorola completely out of any future broader-based market. In 1947, the Federal Communications Commission, FCC, had put tight limits on the airwaves, so that at any one time only 23 different channels could be used for phones in the entire country. The early car phones were extremely expensive and, not surprisingly, rare. In 1948, about 5,000 people in 100 cities could make regular calls. Hardly a booming business. A caller had to stop and park his car, wait for up to an hour to get a free line, and be able to tell an operator the whereabouts of the person they wanted to reach. The network was basically a giant shared party line and usually overloaded. The engineering solution to this congested network had been devised in 1947, but would not actually be put in place until almost 40 years later. Richard Frankiel and Joe Engel of Bell Labs created plans for a system of applied computers and electronics that would carry the signal around a city through invisible, contiguous wireless cells. With such a system covering an entire region, signals could be passed from one cell to another and serve multiple users at the same time, rather than depend on access to a few solitary towers. By 1968, the FCC had dropped their opposition to cell phones and set the stage for the contest, declaring that they would sell off the rights to use a certain bandwidth within which a cell system of mobile communication could work. Bell Labs, the engineering heirs of Alexander Graham Bell and the team that had produced the actual plans for the system, were selected to come up with the first operating mobile phone in the United States. Part of AT&T, Bell Labs had the advantage. Robert Galvin's father, Paul, the founder of Motorola, was already hooked on an AT&T product. The senior Galvin loved driving about with his mobile phone in his Chrysler, calling friends simply to show off the fancy gadget. His son Robert did not think that the world needed or would come to want a hulking phone in every car. If Motorola could take those big cumbersome phones and antennas out of cars and homes and make them truly portable, then AT&T would not be granted exclusive control of the airwaves. Shortly after the new year of 1973, the FCC had slated a hearing to consider granting AT&T a monopoly on these airwaves. Robert Galvin was not about to let that happen. He had 6 weeks. Motorola was well aware that nearly 30 years before, Bell Labs had invented the first working cell phone using a wireless signal that moved through the air. So, they understood that if they didn't show that they had their own device that required public access to these wireless bandwidths, they would lose what could turn out to be a highly profitable opportunity. The race was on. A memo that a senior executive of Motorola, Martin Cooper, wrote at the end of October of 1972 laid it all out. "What the world really needs," he declared, "is a handheld portable phone." He sketched a plan for a long-range project looking at a personal, portable telephone. "We have to do something spectacular." Some of his colleagues were doubtful, but Cooper's enthusiasm echoed that of President Kennedy from the previous decade. "If we could put a man on the moon, then we could certainly figure out how to compress the innards of a car phone into something that could be carried around." The proposal to make a mobile phone was bold, but it was certainly not absurd. Most of the technologies needed to build such a phone, smaller transistors, more powerful batteries, faster working processors, were already under development at Motorola. Indeed, the name of the firm comes from its first claim to fame, making car radios, a combination of Motor and Victrola, the brand name of one of the first primitive hand-cranked record players. "We had a religion about making personal communications products smaller and lighter," Cooper years later told American Heritage Online. "This religion rested on a complex and sophisticated set of engineering breakthroughs in the wings that Cooper was quite familiar with." In the 19th century, Jules Verne had imagined that people would be able to talk to one another across long distances. Handheld communicators fascinated science fiction writers and their fans. "Beam us up, Scotty," throughout the 20th century. In the comics, Dick Tracy depended on the good guy detective's ability to summon help at the right time by talking into his two-way radio wristwatch. Funding for science and technology surged in the middle decades of what many had begun to call the American Century. It had become a matter of national pride that Americans regularly unleashed new technologies in many very different markets. In the fall of 1972, executives like Galvin and Martin Cooper at Motorola believed that the space-age glamour of a working handheld portable phone would wow the FCC commissioners and be just the kind of wondrous product the country wanted. A working model of an actual portable phone was worth 1,000 pages of technical diagrams. At one Motorola demonstration of the new device, Cooper mentioned that the frequency at which these portable phones would operate was 800 megahertz. One of the FCC commissioners had asked, "What's a megahertz?" The officials they had to wow were not electronically literate. Waves. While one might expect a government regulator of the electronics industry would have a rudimentary grasp of how electricity works, it wasn't the case in the 70s, and it has not been an essential criterion since. For most of us, electricity is much like air or water. Open a faucet, water flows. Flip a switch, the room lights up. How electrical power is generated, travels around the world, and carries information is something other people take care of. Electricity travels in waves, like those that arrive on the edges of a pond into which a stone is tossed. Think of a still, round fishing hole on a country farm. As a bass rises to the surface to snap up a mayfly, its motion releases gentle circles that spread outward onto the water surface in regular waves. If we throw a small pebble into the pond's center, concentric, uniform waves will move slowly to its shores from the spot where the pebble lands. If a much larger and heavier stone lands in the center, it makes much higher waves. The distance from the peak of one wave to the top of the next is commonly referred to as the wavelength. Waves can also be described by how fast they move and how much power they pack. Their speed depends on the material through which they travel, and their power depends on their amplitude, example, on the height of the waves on the pond. The frequency of electromagnetic fields and waves is measured in units that are called hertz. This unit was named after the physicist Heinrich Hertz. Before his death at age 36 in 1894, Hertz was the first to practically demonstrate that electromagnetic waves could be transmitted through free space at the speed of light. Hertz himself developed a nearly mystical view of the nature of scientific knowledge about electricity and the physics of waves. One cannot escape the feeling that these mathematical formulas have an independent existence and an intelligence of their own, that they are wiser than we are, wiser even than their discoverers, that we get more out of them than was originally put into them. A single hertz is one cycle per second, about the pace of a resting athletic heart. Electromagnetic waves that light and heat and power our homes sometimes operate at 60 hertz, or Hz. This means that it takes 1/60th of a second for each peak to wend its way through the various wires and transformers in which it travels to power our vacuum cleaners, dishwashers, and clothes dryers. Devices that do not require wires operate at frequencies between 9,000 and 300 billion hertz. Mega comes from the Latin term for million. Thus, 1 megahertz, written as 1 MHz, is a million cycles per second, faster than anyone could count. Wireless cell phones use pulsed frequency waves from 0.05 to over 100,000 megahertz. All radio frequency signals are invisible, and they can pass unobserved into anything not encased in metal and deposit energy into anything that contains water, including the human body. Because radio frequency radiation employed by cell phones cannot be seen and cannot be felt by most of us except when strong enough to warm our bodies, it was at first believed to have no impact on living tissue other than heating. All forms of radiation move in waves. The distance between wave crests provides one way to measure radiation of all kinds. Ionizing radiation produced by X-rays can be tens or hundreds of millions of times smaller than those of radio, television, walkie-talkies, pagers, and cell phones. The closer the spacing of waves on the pond, the faster the surface of the water is said to move or oscillate. The faster waves oscillate, the higher their frequency and the more energy they carry. The fastest oscillating waves, those of X-rays or cosmic rays from outer space, are in fact most damaging, both in the short run and in the long run. Thus, a single atom bomb blast at Hiroshima and Nagasaki released lethal radiation that killed hundreds of thousands right away and destroyed their homes and neighborhoods. This same solitary blast was shown years later to have caused thousands of others who survived the blast to die of cancer and other degenerative chronic illnesses. Electromagnetic waves' ability to travel depends on how long they are. The faster a wave oscillates and the smaller it is, the shorter the distance it can reach. Different frequency electromagnetic waves can be thought of in terms of sounds. A deep, low, sonorous voice projects over a much longer distance, while a high, whiny-pitched yelp does not. If you stand next door, a tinny, shrill chirp cannot be heard, while a big, booming bass guitar thunders through the walls. If invisible light rays could be heard, they would be nearly inaudible. Those of X-rays would be completely silent. Cell phone radiation would be louder, but still not much more than a whisper. Of course, Motorola believed that microwaves could and should enable their new phones to work in a completely benign way. All they had to worry about, so they thought, was that the components didn't get hot or heat up things around them. One of the first medical uses of electricity had been to promote the healing of sore or strained muscles, with a technique that generated an internal warmth and increased blood flow to stressed body parts. Since the healing baths of ancient Rome, it's been understood that the warm temperature can heal and soothe a stiff body. The right amounts of electric current made it possible to heat the body from the inside out. The engineers reasoned that so long as the mobile phones produced no measurable change in temperature, they could not have any other biological effect. Heat, after all, is nothing but molecules moving faster than they do at cooler temperatures. Heat can be easily measured and easily controlled. With the right insulating materials, or at the lowest level of radiation, heat can become irrelevant. In the decades following the world's first atomic bomb, the dangers of the most deadly form of energy, ionizing radiation, had become clear to the whole world. Ionizing radiation, such as X-rays and gamma rays, has enough energy at such ultra-high frequencies that it can break the ionic bonds that hold compounds together. Throughout the universe, whether that material is found in comets in the solar system or within our bodies. It became a fundamental tenet for some scientists that rays that were not ionizing, like any radiation with longer oscillating wavelengths, had to be harmless. If non-ionizing radiation didn't break ionic bonds, and the intensity used was too low to produce any change in temperature, what trouble could it possibly cause? The first team to create a mobile phone model simply assumed that it was not possible for radio frequency radiation to have any biological impact. Few at the time realized that low levels of X-rays could cause longer-term health problems, so the lack of interest in the possibility that non-ionizing radiation could be a health hazard at that time is understandable. Alice Stewart was one of the United Kingdom's foremost epidemiologists. In 1998, when she stayed at my home for the evening, we talked into the late hours about the extraordinary challenges she had documenting health risks of low levels of X-rays. She had drawn much criticism in the late 1950s when she began asking women directly to explain their experiences during pregnancy. Until then, medical researchers relied on written records, often difficult to decipher, to determine what patients had undergone during their pregnancies. Having trained as a physician and given birth to two children, Stewart had a keen appreciation of both worlds. Rather than rely on what their doctors reported, Stewart interviewed mothers directly. What she found would change the way the world thought about X-rays. Women who went through X-ray exams during pregnancy had 3 times a greater chance of producing children who developed leukemia by the time they were age 5. When Stewart first suggested in 1956 that routine exams of pregnant women with X-rays increased the risk that their children would develop childhood cancer, she was pilloried and ridiculed. It was ridiculous, some argued, to think that women would have sound memories of their medical experiences. After all, low doses of X-rays were supposed to be safe. Not until the 1980s, after the medical establishment repeatedly confirmed what Stewart had reported in the 1950s, was the damaging impact of X-rays in pregnancy broadly accepted. Meanwhile, studies continued to emerge from the Hiroshima and Nagasaki atomic bombings, showing that survivors who had incurred lower exposures to X-rays were developing cancers at much greater rates than anyone had expected. Given the resistance the medical community had shown to accepting the dangers of X-rays, and the potentially huge markets for products that use wireless non-ionizing radiation, the disinterest in exploring potential harm from cell phones is not surprising. Today, there is no debate that X-rays directly disturb electrons, break their bonds, disrupt the making of proteins, and impede the ability of cells to fix damage. And yet there has not really been much debate about the potential dangers of radiation from cell phones. It's been assumed they are safe. This is yet another disconnect surrounding cell phones. The absence of definitive evidence that radio frequency radiation has already damaged millions is a questionable basis for assuming that no such damage could possibly occur in the future. Our more than 10 billion-year-old universe is jam-packed with naturally generated electromagnetic waves that link planets, molecules, and living matter. Life on Earth evolved from the very low-energy Schumann waves that come from the Earth's ionospheric resonance to the very high-energy gamma and cosmic rays. Until our societies became electrified with long-wave radio at the dawn of the 20th century, shortwave radio for warfare in the 1940s, and the more recent growth in microwaves for radar, cooking, and now phones, the level of microwaves in our solar system had not changed for eons. With the advent of our electrified modern life, we and all other living creatures on this planet are flooded in a sea of radiation never before encountered in our evolutionary history. We live in the age of the microwave. Robert Wilson and Arno Penzias received the Nobel Prize in 1978 for discovering the cosmic microwave and other signals that supported the theory of the Big Bang that occurred about 15 billion years ago. This explosive colossus of radiation, matter, and energy gave rise to all the wonders of nature and civilization we observe today. It is sobering to think that the microwaves found in the world today and spewed from that primordial explosion are billions of times less frequent than those emitted by the planet's cell phones and other devices today. The current recommended maximum exposure guidance levels for man-made radio frequency radiation that are used worldwide are over a trillion times the natural level that we were exposed to less than 100 years ago. The last national survey of radio frequency radiation was conducted 3 decades ago. The race. People who become engineers usually don't get much training in the origins of the universe or human biology and aren't always in great physical shape. But Cooper and the other fellows running Motorola in the early 70s included a few hardcore athletes. Their friendly competition extended to the annual tennis tournament, where Cooper usually held sway. Several of the group had applied to become astronauts, a program that required Marine Corps basic training regimens, which culminated in days of no sleep, little food, and extraordinary physical challenges. Ray Rudy Crullup was one of those early runners who could often be found pounding the pavement, inside or out, to stay in shape for his favorite wintertime outdoor activity, skiing. Like many men of their right stuff generation, the Motorola engineers loved to compete, and if that meant staying up all night for a few days to get something done, they were game. Crullup, who would become one of the leaders of the effort to build a mobile phone, had a very important personal goal to meet as well. An avid skier, he wanted to get the project done in time to make a long-planned trip out west with his wife. And he loved the idea of beating AT&T at their own game. Bell Labs, then part of AT&T, had made the first phones to work in police cars and thought they were comfortably ahead of Motorola. Engineers and architects have a long tradition of creating teams that raced to complete tasks, often working through the night to do so. In 19th-century France, at Paris's renowned architecture school, École des Beaux-Arts, design contests came to be known as charrettes, for the horse-drawn chariots in which plans were rushed to the judges. Teams of architects would compete to draft plans for bridges or buildings overnight that then had to be transported through the streets of Paris on carts, literally, en charrette. It was not unusual to find experts working on last-minute changes while en route. In much the same gung-ho spirit, Motorola Research and Development Chief Cooper called in Crollop on the Monday after Thanksgiving, December 4, 1972, and told him he had 6 weeks or less to build a small device that could send and receive voice messages without wires and could be held in the hand, a wireless portable phone. Crollop had never heard of or imagined such a thing. His first response was, "What the hell is a mobile phone?" The possibility of mobile phones had already captured the imagination of the entertainment industry. Besides Jules Verne and Dick Tracy, Ian Fleming's spy novels had been turned into razzle-dazzle films featuring the dashing James Bond. 007 always managed to get the girl and talked into pens, books, or flashlights to reach the good guys and root out the bad ones. In the 1960s, Mel Brooks and Buck Henry wrote a television comedy series, Get Smart, featuring Maxwell Smart, a character mixing the dashing Bond with Peter Sellers' bumbling detective, Inspector Clouseau. One of Smart's standard shticks was to speak into what looked like an ordinary shoe. Operator: "What number are you calling?" Smart:
"I'm calling control, operator."
Operator: "You have dialed incorrectly. Give me your name and address, and your dime will be refunded." Smart:
"Operator, I'm calling from my shoe."
Operator: "What is the number of your shoe?" Smart:
"It's an unlisted shoe, operator."
To use or answer the shoe phone, Agent Smart had to take off his shoe. Dialing 117 converted the shoe into a gun, but, of course, left Smart unable to make a fast getaway on foot. Throughout the series, Smart would talk into a variety of ordinary objects that became phones, including a wristwatch, an alarm clock, a handkerchief, a magazine, a garden hose, a car cigarette lighter — the cigarette lighter was hidden in the car phone — a necktie, a belt, a wallet, and a jock strap, about which Smart asked his boss to please ring only once. The program included a number of other gadgets that were electronically impossible at the time. There was a bulletproof invisible wall in Smart's apartment that lowered from the ceiling, a candid camera lurking under a full bowl of soup that, with each spoonful, took a picture, with a conspicuous flash, of the person eating the soup, and a powerful miniature laser weapon in the button of a sport jacket.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.